Oh, hello everyone! In the following video I dealt with the restoration of an IBM clone, however as I proceeded I encountered many difficulties due to its poor state of conservation. Therefore I preferred, due to the amount of footage, to divide the video into two parts and divide in turn the parts in chapters, which you will find below in the description. Also, on the days I was filming, I didn't have the camera tripod with me, so I apologize in advance for the shaky footage. Now stop just talk and let's go straight to the point. This filthy computer is an IBM XT clone. It is PCBit branded and actually it is an Italian clone, manufactured by the company Bit Computers. Until 1988, the company had a significant rise in Italy, becoming fourth for the sale and distribution of computers, after Olivetti, IBM and Apple, as stated by the company itself in this advertisement of the time. However, in 1988, this Italian company was sued by IBM for its PCB286 line of computers, and IBM won the lawsuit, causing the PCB286 to be withdrawn from the market. I could only find this information online. If anyone knew more about it, let me know in the comments. Talking about the actual PC, it is in horrendous condition. I haven't even tried to turn it on. Let's take a look inside. There is dirt, rust, corrosion everywhere, even on the ISA slots. These slots are all ISA, so somewhere there is the Intel 8088 processor. Here it is. There is a standard IBM sort of 130W power supply. Then below we have a 20MB Seagate ST225 MFM hard disk. On the front panel there are two floppy drives, one 5.25 and the other 3.5 inches. I have no idea if these work, but the top of the 3.5 is very rusty, so we will see. On the ISA slots there is a graphics card, probably monochrome. Next to it we have a serial and parallel port, followed by an MFM controller of an unknown brand, never heard of. And next to it, we have the floppy controller. So, a rather common machine for the time, but fascinating for its legal history. It is currently too dirty for me to take it to my workbench, so let's see what can be done about it. This is the computer motherboard. It is particularly rusty. I pulled it out of the case by sawing off some screws, which were too rusty to be unscrewed. There is a lot of rust on the pins of the ROMs and the processor, and on the whole motherboard there is a lot of corrosion. I doubt it works. Fast update, I tested the motherboard and I got absolutely nothing. No sound, no video, no beeps, as turned off. I thought that the processor was dead, so I tried to remove it from the socket, but the processor pins were completely detached due to rust, so the next step is to remove all the ICs, try to repair the destroyed pins and submerge the motherboard into the vinegar, so I hope to wake it up. Clearly I will do all these off camera, cause the process is too long and tedious. I start to repair the pins of the motherboard chips, including the processor. I checked in continuity mode and all the pins make contact. I did the same jobs on the BIOS ROMs, and so will I do on the rest of it of the damaged chips on the MOBO, which are quite a lot as you can see. While repairing this MOBO, and my hopes are very low, I managed to find this other one, decidedly more modern, with an Intel 386SX at 25MHz. The problem with this motherboard is battery acid, which has corroded some traces and made it impossible to use the keyboard. Corrosion has also passed on the other side, so, as usual, I will make extensive use of vinegar. Together with the Mobo, I also took this floppy IDE controller because the one installed on the broken motherboard, it is not working, and after all it is just a floppy controller, so who cares. The affected area is this, where we can see how the acid oxidation of the battery has also extended to the connector and to the first ISA slot. Before starting, it will be necessary to remove this blob of hot glue, which come off easily. Subsequently, I soak a cotton swab of white vinegar and cleaned the visible oxidation around the battery connector, the AT connector, and wherever I see suspicious green. After reacting the vinegar with the oxidation for about 15 minutes, I spray the isopropyl alcohol, and to clean the area I use a common toothbrush. Carefully clean the board, set the multimeter in continuity mode, I'm going to look for any broken traces to be repaired. In fact, I immediately find a damaged trace which lacks part of the copper. The trace goes underneath the keyboard connector, so I'll have to remove it and check below. But first, I want to test it again to see if eliminating corrosion has helped in some way. And the Mobo works, but the keyboard does not as expected. So, back to the solder. Remove the connector just enough for the test, I measure in continuity the track I was talking about before, and in fact it is broken like the adjacent one. The tracks start from pin 1 and pin 4 of the keyboard connector. Those two tracks weren't the only broken, and in the end I had to remove the keyboard connector again, the AT connector, the keyboard controller socket and the BIOS chip, only to find that there was another broken track between the battery connector and the ground. And I don't know why, but without this track the keyboard was not working. But now we have a working motherboard and I managed to boot MS-DOS 6.22 from floppy disk. While on the workbench my IBM is formatting the HDD, I put myself on the ground to reassemble the case that I cleaned out of camera with the new motherboard and the original components where possible. During the reassembly process, I also decided to clean and lubricate the two floppy disks drive, an operation absolutely necessary only to be able to test their operation. The procedure to restore operation involves in order 1. Disassembly of the electronic part, 2. Cleaning the metal rails on which the head slides with isopropyl alcohol, 3. Lubrication of the rails with silicone spray oil, 4. Cleaning of the heads with cotton swab and isopropyl alcohol, and 5. Lubrication of the sliding mechanical part with lithium grease. In addition to routine cleaning, it is also good to remove dirt in general. Here we see the front plate before cleaning, and here we see the whole drive after the overhaul and cleaning. There is a bit of dust left in the lower part of the plate, but in the improvement it's at least 90%. Here we see two disk drives. They are both Seagate ST225, both 20 MB. The one on the left, the most worn, was mounted in the PC bit, but unfortunately it was ruined to the point of being unusable. The drive on the right is functional. I formatted it with an IBM XT Model 26 using the program provided with the Advanced Diagnostic Diskette for IBM 5170. So to use it with another controller and on another motherboard I will have to format it again, but this is served to verify correct operation. However, since I am going to mount the HDD on the right, I will remove the original HDD plate and mount it on the replacement. That remains take care of the wiring inside the case and try to turn it on. So the motherboard works as programmed, the controller recognizes the HDD, but does not boot from there, and instead of trying to boot from the floppy, it crashes. I took his matching monitor from the warehouse, and it only works if I put it on the left side. If I put it straight, it does not go. It loses the horizontal sync. Overall, it has its charm. It seems the monitor of the Xerox Alto, however, it is not what we need. Okay, I managed to load MS-DOS and start the low-level format utility, and this was only possible by loading MS-DOS 3.3 from 5.25-inch floppy. I don't know why. If anyone knows why the bug was not working on MS-DOS 6.22, please write it in the comments. Anyway, now I'm formatting the HDD. In the meantime, it is needed to repair this monitor. As we have seen, the monitor only works in a certain position, so I believe this behavior is due to bad welding or broken traces. As always, I provide this warning: you must never open a cathode ray tube or try to repair it. Inside the cathode tube, there are very high voltages, we're talking about 20,000 volts, and they're also present with the monitor switched off for some time. The tube itself acts like a large capacitor, and if you touch the positive pole with one hand and the negative or ground of your home with the other hand, the current will pass through your chest, stopping your heart and killing you. So never open a cathode ray tube unless you know what to do. I myself am absolutely not qualified at all to do this, and I take all the risk to take it apart. This is not a guide. With that said, let's get started. There is no reason to completely remove the card from the case. Even from here, I can work on it. My purpose here is to touch each bulb with the soldering iron and add a little tin to make an acceptable connection, since I can't see damaged weld to the eye. Okay, let's turn it on and try it, and it does not work. Nothing on the screen, completely dead. After a bit of troubleshooting, I discovered that by hitting the monitor analog board, I accidentally unsoldered a component. It is now fixed and working properly. The next point to fix is the video card. For now, I have tested the computer and the monitor using my original MDA IBM, cause the video card that was in the computer does not work. So it is time to get our hands on it, but not before having lubricated and cleaned with the deoxidizer, the contrast and brightness knobs. This is the original monochromatic display adapter that was installed in the computer, and when I try to turn it on, it does not work. Now, the only elements that can't prevent this card from working are the chips, since I have not seen broken traces or clues in this regard, and since the only capacitors present on the card are either intact electrolytic or ceramic, my first attempt will therefore be to remove all the chips and thoroughly clean the sockets with white vinegar. If it does not work, I will try to measure the voltages on the line of the RAM chips with the oscilloscope. This card has two banks of 8 4164 RAM chips, and the chips are 64 kilobit OKI. These chips are unreliable and often don't work properly, so it is an alarm bell to keep in mind. But for the moment, let's start with a deep cleaning based on white vinegar. In the RAM area, it will seem all clean as long as we move towards the connectors where we see that there is some strange white corrosion. We start reassembling all the chips in the right position. We assembled the chips, we put it straight into the computer and see how it behaves. Once the monitor is turned on, we see that there is nothing on the screen, but the raster pattern changes during the post of the computer, so it is necessary to work on it. There are some pins that have been inserted incorrectly. As you can see, here two pins have been inserted sideways on the socket. This is a good lesson, so you should never be in a hurry checking these kind of things. Attempt number 2 and no appreciable results. Reinserted the card, I tried to touch the chips with my hand to feel if there is someone hotter than the others, and it seems to me that some RAM chips are heating up a lot. Fortunately, I have another RAM bank of the right size, so I don't know if it works or not, but it's worth a try. The chips are not in the best possible condition, the pins are a little rusty, so I hope they make contact. Turning on the monitor and the computer, we get strange characters on the screen, which usually indicates RAM problems. So I try to leave it for a while and see if there are any temperature differences in the chips, as I did before, to try to figure it out if there are any malfunctioning ICs. I have not changed the RAM chips, but I resetted them with the help of a little electric deoxidizer, and now I get this cursor on the top. We are on track, I will remove all the chips from the board again and reinsert them after spraying the deoxidizer. Electric deoxidizer has done its job and now the video card works. I want to try to reassemble the original chips at this point, maybe it works with those too. And yes, I was right, the RAM Occibank works. We can move on to another scheduled point of this restoration, namely to repaint the 3.5-inch floppy drive. Okay, this is the bay on which the drive will be mounted. It is very dirty, it will have to be cleaned, and this is the spur drive, because its floppy drive was not working properly. The electronics were good, but the mechanics were too rusty. Now, beyond the fact that the adapter bay and the drive have two slightly different colors, all the other plates on the front panel are black, and although at the time it was usual to have 3.5-inch white drive and all the other blacks, as is often seen in IBM XT, I have never liked it, so to overcome the two problems, I will paint the front part of the bay and the floppy plate black, cause that I shown on video turned out to be incompatible with the drive I had chosen.